आप में से ब्लड कैंसर कितनों को है? ब्लड कैंसर वाले खड़े हो जाओ, ब्लड कैंसर 3 महीने में अच्छा हो जाता है।
That was Baba Ramdev telling everyone that 3 months of yoga can cure blood cancer.
You know, I'm something of a scientist myself.
I've always wondered how does someone get fooled by something like this so easily? I mean, if it was so easy to cure blood cancer, all medical researchers would thank Ramdev, shut down their offices and go home. But that doesn't happen. Now, I'm not trying to judge yoga by the words of Ramdev or anything, but what enables him or people like him to say, hey, here you go, this will cure everything, and expect people to believe him, let alone give him their money and expect to get away with it scot-free. Of course, that last part isn't true for Ramdev anymore. But I want to answer this question of why is it so easy to fool people? My name's Pranav. You're watching DT Rational. Let's begin. This video is brought to you by my supporters on Patreon, Buy Me a Coffee, Nas.io and YouTube. If you wish to support me, you can find the links below. I want you to look at these two images. In particular, look at that central horizontal line and tell me which one is longer. I'll give you 3 seconds to pause and think of an answer. 3, 2, 1. The bottom one, I feel, is longer. And that's probably what most of you thought too. But the fact is, they're both the same length. Now that you know they're the same length, let's look at that image again. Can you tell they're the same length? You probably can't. Many of you might have already seen this. It's a famous optical illusion that makes you think you're seeing one thing when that's not true. There are tons of other optical illusions. They all exploit the same fact. Our brain, the organ with which we process all information, is flawed. It can easily be fooled. But here's the interesting part. Now that you know that the lines are the same length, when you look at the image again, you still see them as different lengths. All you can do is ignore what your automatic judgment is telling you, mistrust your intuition, and go with what the facts are. The lines are the same length. It's like you have no control over what you automatically judge. Facts are usually separate from your personal judgment. You'll see this plays an important role later on in the video. Now, illusions are not always a problem of the eye. They're a problem of the brain, of the processing in the brain, because there are cognitive illusions. Here's an example. I bought a bat and a ball for 110 rupees. The bat costs 100 rupees more than the ball. How much did they each cost? The quick answer that you might arrive at is the bat costs 100 and the ball costs 10 rupees. But this is wrong. It's 1/5 for the bat and 5 for the ball. And you'll see why when you think about it more deliberately, more slowly and more carefully. Here's another example. 5 people can draw 5 paintings in 5 hours. How many hours will it take for 10 people to draw 10 paintings? You might be tempted to say 10, but the answer is 5. Think about it. The wrong answer might initially seem like the right one to you because of a cognitive illusion. Now, I'm sure you can think of many such examples, but why are our brains prone to this? We evolved in a world where we needed resources for survival, where there were predators and other threats to our survival. And in between all this, we had to take every opportunity to pass on our genes. And if we didn't, our lineage will be wiped out of existence. We evolved in a world where if we did these things, that's a perfect life. All our brains needed to do was evolve in a way where we prioritized these things that we need for survival and reproduction. This is not just true for humans, but for all animals, all living beings, I should say. So things that were good for survival rewarded our brains with pleasure, and things that threatened our survival give our brains fear and pain. Our brains optimized for this desire to feel pleasure or to avoid that fear of pain. But somewhere in the evolution of humans, we evolved intelligence, and we began to select intelligence in our mates because more intelligent offspring were better users and makers of tools and fire, and hence better survivors. Eventually, the human species became so intelligent that given a complex math problem, they can figure out how to solve it. But we still had that automatic judgment, that intuition that optimized for pleasure versus pain, not for true versus false. Even today, we haven't evolved much beyond this point. We're still the same species we were tens of thousands of years ago. Normally, pleasure and pain will correlate with true and false, but not always. For example, when you go against the beliefs of your peers or the people around you, you might be going with what's true, but it'll cause you a lot of pain to go against your social circle, especially given that we're social beings. This optimization for pleasure versus pain over true versus false is what comes in the way of us seeing through scams. This is what makes it very easy to fool us. Let's see how. We'd like to think that we are creatures of logic and reason, but we're far more emotional than logical. Our actions are controlled to a great degree by desire and fear. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that emotions are a bad thing. They're what makes us appreciate art, music, and poetry. They're what makes us fall in love, and they're what makes us care for one another in times of need. But these same emotions can lead us astray sometimes. Here's an example. You're suffering from some serious medical condition and someone might say, I had stage 4 stomach cancer and this new innovative treatment by Baba Ramdev completely cured me. Now the doctors see my scans and they say it's a miracle I'm still alive. You should try this Baba's medicine. That might sound like a very compelling case for the medicine. And in your desperation to find a cure, you might believe it. But if you do, you've just been fooled, because your pleasure versus pain optimization system has fallen prey to a logical fallacy. All you know based on what the person said is, and remember, you don't know how trustworthy this person is, but all you know right now is, they had cancer, they took Baba Ramdev's medicine, and now they're better. That could have happened for a number of reasons. Cancers are sometimes known to go into remission, basically shrink, and that could have happened with this person. Next, just because the treatment was done, doesn't mean the recovery was caused by the treatment. A happened, B happened, and then C happened doesn't mean B caused C. There could have been something else that the patient took that caused the recovery. Like modern medicine, often the patients that go to Ramdev have taken some form of modern medical care.
My husband took me to the doctor. They gave me a CT scan, PET scan, and they told me that it can't be done.
They might have thought that it has no effect, when in fact it could have been taking time to take effect, during which time they took Baba Ramdev's treatment and recovered, but decided to credit their entire recovery to Ramdev's treatment. You can often see such stories in all kinds of alternative medicine. And if this story is being narrated by that alternative medicine provider, I can assure you that it's hugely exaggerated in favor of the alternative medicine. And in your desperate and emotional need for a cure, you might end up leaving the story. This emotionality is also a reason why we come to these sudden and comfortable answers. Remember the math problem I gave you two chapters ago? The bat and ball example and the painter's example? We initially come up with wrong answers because we feel safer with those answers, especially because they're multiples of 10. And the question itself is phrased in such a way that we feel safer with those answers. They're more comfortable, and this safety and comfort feels good. And the pleasure versus pain optimization system will point us towards this answer. But there are more such quirks of our brains. Imagine you enter a room that's specially constructed so that the floor is tilted to one side. It's easier to walk down the slope to one side of the room, but it's harder to walk up the slope to the other side. A bias is similar, but in your mind. Given a situation, you will have a tendency to always conclude in one direction more than the other. For example, in favor of your favorite political party. For example, we're all prone to the I can't be wrong bias, where we conclude in favor of whichever conclusion means we're not wrong. Where given a situation, like say, I make a video criticizing Ayurveda or your favorite alternative medicine. Now, I've criticized Ayurveda in the past for being a pseudoscience, so let's take that for example. Assuming that you're someone who believes Ayurveda to be great, There are two possible conclusions you might make in your mind after watching my video. Either I'm right or I'm wrong. If I'm right, that means that you're wrong. But you have the I can't be wrong bias. Then you'll conclude in favor of the other possibility, which is that I'm wrong, which means that I'm doing this because I'm against Ayurveda. I'm anti-Ayurveda. And then these people also see that I criticize ideas like Vedic maths, Vedic astrology, ideas from Hinduism, the Indian government's propagation of pseudoscience, and you might end up making a conclusion that I'm anti-Hindu or anti-India. Completely ignoring the fact that I've made videos praising Indian scientists and the genuine scientific contributions that came out of India. It's the same I'm not wrong bias that makes you think of people who don't support your favorite political party as anti-national, say. This is also what makes you think of people who have an opposite political leaning to yours as librandu or bigot. All kinds of tribalism can be explained by this. Even something as simple as people being fans of a different sports club than you. You see them as a sworn enemy. Okay, that may be an exaggeration, but you get my point. And all these biases exist because we optimize for pleasure versus pain over true and false. Now, I have a video where I've described a lot of biases in detail. Go check that out if you're interested. How do you overcome or fix a bias that you have? The simple answer is you can't. It's a property of human thinking. One thing you could do is recognize and be aware that you may be biased or the opinion you're hearing may be biased, and instead rely not on opinions but on facts, on evidence. I'll talk about this in more detail at the end of this video. Another thing you could do is work around those biases. This is often done by setting protocols, and you often see this in medical research. In medical trials, there are two arms in a study, the medicine arm and the placebo arm, where the patients are given either the medicine or a placebo in each arm. The participants don't know which arm of the trial they're in. They may be receiving the medicine being tested or a placebo against which this medicine's efficacy is being tested. At the same time, the medical professional who is administering the medicine or placebo to the patient doesn't know what they're administering. This is called double blinding, and it keeps whatever bias the patient or the medical practitioner might have from affecting the results, the conclusions. Let's now look at more patterns of erroneous thinking that we fall prey to. Rahul says to his brother, "Don't smoke, it's bad for your lungs." And his brother replies by saying, "But you smoke all the time." Rahul's brother has fallen prey to a whataboutery fallacy, where he thinks that just because someone smokes, their advice against smoking becomes invalid. You can often see this in political or religious arguments where people respond with, "What about you?" or "What about them?" Just because someone else does something doesn't make it all right for you to do it too. If smoking is bad for the lungs, that only depends on what evidence is there to support that fact, not on who else smokes. Of course, Rahul can be criticized for being a hypocrite, but that doesn't make a statement right or wrong. A logical fallacy is when you arrive at a conclusion by applying logic that is erroneous, like in this example that I showed you just now. And logical fallacies are an interesting topic to study and learn to spot in arguments. I made a detailed video on this also, and a game as well that you can play while watching a logically erroneous video and learn to try to spot the fallacy. I've also linked a document down below where I've described the meanings of all these fallacies and also the biases, the different biases that I spoke about earlier. Now, unlike biases, logical fallacies are easier to avoid, but it helps a lot in being aware of them and how they can creep up in arguments. So far, I've shown you how human thinking is often flawed and how we reach wrong conclusions simply because we optimize for pleasure versus pain, and how that doesn't always correlate with true or false. But even if we do everything correctly, that is, we account for all biases and make sure we're not committing any fallacies, we can still go wrong. How? If our initial assumptions are wrong. We take our initial assumption as true for granted. For example, an assumption from your religion you might believe is true, and starting with that assumption, the conclusion you reach might be wrong. Another assumption that people make is they decide to trust a politician, and conclusively they might vote for him and end up regretting it later. Another assumption that people sometimes start with is on the efficacy of alternative medicine, or some kind of bodily energy assumption that might lead you to conclude in favor of spirituality. Always question your assumptions. Is there any valid reason supporting the assumption that you're taking for granted as true? Like, say, evidence. If there is evidence, how robust is it? Is it as robust as the claim it's supporting? Because a flimsy piece of evidence can never be enough to support an extraordinary claim. Hint, I'm talking about religion. Now, since we're on the topic, and this is what I mentioned earlier about how we can, you know, combat wrong conclusions, be it a product of a fallacy or bias or a wrong assumption. Basically, if he says one thing and she says another, who do you go with? You might have heard one thing, but I'm saying the opposite. So who do you trust now? The answer is neither person. You go with evidence. Look at how thorough your source of evidence is. See if that evidence has the consensus of experts. Recognize and be aware of the limitations of human thinking. Remember that we fall prey to scams because of this prioritization of pleasure versus pain over true versus false. If you like my content, it'd be really awesome if you could support me, because that becomes my main source of income. You can give me a one-time support using one of these options, or give me continued support using one of these options, for which you will get perks that you see on your screen. One of those perks is a private WhatsApp group that you get to join, where we do stuff like this. One of our members is an astronomer, and so we have amateur astronomy sessions over Zoom call. So if you're interested in things like that, do join. I want to thank my highest tier supporters on Patreon and YouTube. If you support me in my highest tiers, you can get your name displayed on the video like this. If you like this video, you might also like this one. I'll see you in the next video. Till then, remember to stay rational.